Hello friends, in today's class we will learn about directive principles of state policy. We learned directive principles from the perspective of human rights because we saw that the concept of human rights is included mainly in the preamble, in the fundamental rights part, and in directive principles of the state policy in our constitution. So what does this directive principles means? Directive principles denotes the ideals that the state should keep in mind while formulating policies and enacting laws. They are the guidelines available for the state for realizing civil and political rights and bringing social, economic, and political justice to people. Now, the objective of the directive principles of the state policy is to bring a welfare in the state. Now we know the part 4 of the Indian Constitution is the directive principles of state policy. Part 3 is the fundamental rights. Now articles 36 to 51 are the articles coming under this part. One of the peculiarities of the directive principles of state policy is that it is not enforceable. That is the difference between fundamental rights and directive principles of state policy. Fundamental rights are enforceable by courts. They are justiciable rights. That means if your fundamental right is violated, you can approach the Supreme Court and ask for some resolution. But in the case of directive principles of state policy, no such criteria is there. It is the duty of the state to bring these ideals into practice, but we are not entitled to these rights. But the government keep these ideals as their fundamentals while making laws and designing policies for the governments. Now let us quickly go through the different articles of DPSP. Article 38 is about state should secure a social order for the promotion of welfare of the people. Article 39 is the certain principles of policy to be followed by the state. Article 39A, equal justice and free legal aid. Article 40, organization of village panchayats. Article 41, right to work, to education and to public assistance in certain cases. Article 42, provision for just and humane conditions of work and maternity relief. Article 43, living wage for workers. Article 43A, participation of workers in management of industries. Article 43B, promotion of cooperative societies. Article 44, uniform civil code for the citizens. Now we have different civil code, right? Different religious sects have different personal laws for their hereditary, their marriage laws are different. And uniform civil code is mentioned in directive principles of state policy. Article 45, provision for early childhood care and education to children below the age of 6 years. Article 46, promotion of education and economic interest of scheduled castes, scheduled tribes and other weaker sections. Article 47, duty of the state to raise the level of nutrition and the standard of living. Article 48, organization of agriculture and animal husbandry. Article 48A, protection and improvement of environment and safeguarding of forests and wildlife. Article 49, protection of monuments and places and objects of national importance. Article 50, separation of judiciary from executive. Article 51, promotion of internal peace and security. So just go through these articles, and when you look at the meaning of each of the articles, you understand that these are some of the ideals that we want in order to bring justice and equality in the society. So these all are the core and heart of many of the human rights that we learned. So if the government is bringing all these policies into practice through various laws and other schemes, we will be able to have an equality and justice in the society. So directive principles were implemented through various laws and schemes in the country. For example, if we look at some of the laws that were enforced, we know Article 38 speaks about securing a social order for the promotion of welfare of the people. Now, in the earlier years, we had Planning Commission, and now we have Niti Aayog in order to bring planning and equality among various policies. Niti Aayog is implementing a lot of schemes and policies in order to bring this concept. All the policies undertaken by the government are actually aimed at bringing that social order. Now, if we look at Article 39, certain policies, so certain principles of policy to be followed by the state. And all those kinds of policies are brought by various acts. Suppose Minimum Wages Act 1948 brings the right to have a minimum wage into the realms of legal right. Then under Article 42, we learn that there should be provisions of just and humane conditions of work and maternity relief. In order to bring that into practice, Maternity Benefit Act 1961 was passed. Similarly, Panchayati Raj constitutional amendment was made to bring Panchayati Raj in order to ensure that panchayats and local governance is maintained in the country. So all these laws that we see, Environment and Wildlife Protection Act, that was brought to protect the environment. And protection of environment is mentioned in Article 48A. Then right to education was brought into Article 21A in the fundamental rights part. Earlier it was mentioned in Article 25 as a directive principle of state policy, and later it was moved into fundamental rights. So what I need to mention is that directive principles of state policy are just a set of guidelines defined for the government that they should do and practice in their daily affairs. Through different policies, laws and schemes, the government is implementing these principles into practice. So we have a handful of laws. These are just some examples. There are plenty of laws available in the country, plenty of policies that are implemented in the country that brings us these qualities, these ideas. So the DPSP is a way to ensure human rights in the country by being a guiding lamp. The difference between the DPSP and the fundamental rights is that fundamental rights are already in existence. The moment constitution came into existence, fundamental rights became justiciable and enforceable. But DPSP was just there as a guideline, as a framework for the government. It was later brought into practice through various policies, schemes and laws by the government. So I hope you understood the relevance of DPSP. They contain a lot of provisions in order to bring the equality, fraternity and other noble elements of our constitution. So it tries to bring about the ideals enshrined in the concept of human rights into practice. So that is about DPSP. Thank you.